We just want to take a moment to welcome the people that are joining us online. You aren't here with us in person, we don't blame you. It has been a pretty dicey couple of weeks for weather, and it is safer to stay home, and we just pray that you will be blessed at this time together. We're together in spirit, whether we're together in person or not. We're going to open with a song, In Christ Alone. Stand, you're welcome to, if you'd like to stay seated, whatever you are comfortable with.
Thank you, Mary Lee, and good to see you folks again. Turn your Bibles, if you have them with you today, to the Gospel of John, the last chapter. Just want to read three verses now, but we'll be commenting a lot on the chapter later on in the message. John 21, verse 15. So when they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to him, Tend my lambs. He said to him again a second time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to him, Shepherd my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he had said to him the third time, Do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. May God bless this reading.
Amen. Join me for another song. I'd rather have Jesus. Old favorite. Ben brings the message, and that is trust and obey. Another old favorite. They're the best. Well, not the best, but they're great.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on. Thank you.
So I say it is good to be back here today. It makes a real nice day for us. Get a chance to leave the valley behind and come over to this side. And today we're traveling with our very good friends, Doug and Rita Faust, over here. And you might have met some of them, might have met the Fausts on your recent wonderful baptismal service they held here. It's also, the Fausts are very good friends, Joe and Marion Massup. They're nice to see you folks here today. And it's just good to get together. The story is told of two buffalo standing on the prairies of Alberta. It's early spring and they've just come through a real hard winter. Not enough food, their ribs are showing. And their long winter hair is beginning to fall out with the warmer days of spring, but it's falling out in clumps. Two cowboys ride by these two buffalo. One turns to the other and says, "Aren't those two the ugliest, mangiest buffalo you've ever seen in your entire life?" And once they're out of earshot, one buffalo turns to the other and said, "I think we just heard a discouraging word." So much for home on the range. Well, maybe today you're feeling a little bit like those buffalo. The last 2 years have been difficult. Really difficult with the pandemic. We were told that if we follow the protocols, you know, safe distancing, wear masks, all those things, get our shots, that the pandemic would soon be behind us. It's still not. In fact, there's record numbers of cases with the new Omicron virus. It seems like we're getting just, maybe there's hope, and then another virus shows up. So that's discouraging. There's record high numbers of people dying with the opioid crisis. And I've never seen so many mental health issues talked about as in these days. Lots of discouraging news. For some people, the weather gets them on the west coast of the country, but not enough sunshine, too much rain sometimes. Maybe you're getting tired of the snow being around. And for some people, they get something called seasonal affective disorder, or SADS, and that does negatively impact a number of people. And so there's all these discouraging things around. But I want to be honest with you, I didn't come here today to make you feel worse. I came to bring you an encouraging word today, and that not like those buffalo had to hear. I didn't come from Port Alberni to make you feel bad today. Today, let's look at what day it is. January the 2nd, 2022. Put it in metric terms, 010222. Low numbers for a new beginning. And that's what I've entitled the message today, A Day of New Beginnings. But why do we need a new beginning? Well, it's because we really haven't done all that well in the old. So in our Bibles, if you guys still turn to John chapter 21, if you have them with you today. First, a little background. Peter himself was not doing all that well. He is still carrying the baggage and smarting from how he had behaved on the night that Jesus was falsely accused and condemned to die. He had previously boasted on one occasion that, "Jesus, I'll be with you. I'll stand with you to the end." And then in the courtyard of the temple, he let Jesus down. Even before an unthreatening servant girl, he denied that he knew Jesus. One time, he accompanied his denial with an oath. Or a curse. Three times in short order he denied that he knew Jesus. And that was even after Jesus had warned him with these words, "Before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times." And when Peter denied Jesus the third time, he heard the rooster crow. Struck by the enormity of his sin, the Bible says that Peter went out and wept bitterly. And now, days later, Peter's still not doing well. Even though he had seen the resurrected Jesus, he decided to leave the confusing city, the tough place of Jerusalem, the pressure pot of Jerusalem, and go to Galilee, where he felt more comfortable. And there he was on the shores of the Lake of Galilee, and he said, I'm going to go fishing. And six more disciples said, we're going to go with you too. And so they went out on the water fishing. Oh, it was good to be out in the water again. But it grew old after a while because they tossed their nets. The nets always were coming back empty. They were skunked so far. And a stranger appeared on the shore, at least someone they didn't recognize. And he called out, children, do you have any fish? And they had to begrudgingly answer, no. Try the other side of the boat, and you might find some. Well, that was an understatement. Might find some. They found some. 153, to be exact. 153 good-sized fish. Their nets were so heavy that it was threatening to break them. So Peter went to shore, and then he went back to haul in the nets, and they joined the stranger on the shore. But as soon as they knew, they heard the words on the other side, and they found all these fish, they knew that the stranger was not a stranger, but was Jesus himself. And so on the shore they went. Jesus did a wonderful thing for them. They had fished all night. They were hungry. They were probably cold in the morning chill. And Jesus had this charcoal fire going. And on the sides of the fire, he was toasting bread and cooking fish. And bread and fish go so well together. And these hungry fishermen must really appreciated that meal. And so in the presence of Jesus, they shared this meal together. And then, after the meal was finished, Jesus turned to Peter, and he said, verse 15, Simon Peter, lovest thou me? Do you love me more than these? Do you love me more than these fish that you have just caught? Do you love me more than these fellow fishermen? Do you love me more than your job as a commercial fisherman that you used to have? I have learned from Jesus that one of the best ways to have significant conversations with people is to ask significant questions. And that's what Jesus is doing here. Because questions make people think. Yes. And Peter responded well, and he said, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And Jesus said to him, feed my lambs. Leave the fish behind, Peter. Now concentrate on nurturing the new believers who will soon be believing in me. Verse 16, please. He said to him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? He said to him, yes, Lord. You know that I love you. He said unto him, feed my sheep. If you love me, says Jesus, love my followers too, and feed them. Tend them, shepherd them, lead them. And verse 17, Peter was upset. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? Peter was grieved or upset because he said to him the third time, do you love me? But it's only right that Jesus would ask the same question three times, because three times Peter had denied him. And now three times he's forced to admit that he loves Jesus. But there's more than that happening here. Jesus is reaffirming Peter. And Jesus is recommissioning Peter, who was tempted to go back to his former way of life as a fisherman. It was Jesus letting Peter know that he had not given up on him, but he had great plans for him yet. And that Jesus still saw Peter as being that rock. And together with that confession that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God, that they were going to build a strong foundation for the upcoming Christian church, or at least the Jewish part of it. And Peter did a great job with that. Maybe this morning, on this, the first Sunday of a brand new year, you need to be recommissioned by the Savior. Maybe like Peter, you're feeling like a schmuck for denying Jesus, not just three times, but many. You know, we've all been, I'm sure, in the presence of people who misused the sacred name of Jesus, and it grieved us, it hurt us, but we said nothing. What a difference it might have made if we said something like this: you know, Jesus means a lot to me, and I'm hurt when you use his name like that. But too often we were silent. We let fear hold us back from identifying ourselves as being in the camp of Jesus. Yes, Peter denied Jesus three times. I only wish that my denials of Jesus were that small in number. But it's a matter that we really do need wisdom for. I remember when I was working a summer job in Glen University, I ran into this young man whose mouth was just so foul. And then he began to throw in the name of Jesus, talking about some of those F-bombs and so on too, and I just couldn't take it. And I told him that he had a mouth like an open sewer. I don't suppose that line would be acceptable in Peel's book on how to win friends and influence people. But I bet he didn't forget it, at least for a long time. There's one other story that I'd like to share with you. For 4 years, I ran the Della Falls water taxi on Great Central Lake, taking backpackers up to see one of the highest waterfalls in Canada. And I was really pleased with the general level of how my passengers talked. But one fellow did grieve me. Almost every sentence, every time he opened his mouth, he seemed to use God's name in vain and toss around vile terms. And as I was driving the boat, I was silently praying to God, show me, Lord, what I can do to, so I don't need to put up with this on the way back, and show me what I can do to stop this. And so 2 days later, after he had finished his hike and we were ready to go back the 23 miles down the lake, I sort of pulled him aside, called him by name, and I said, I've got a challenge for you. Well, those are good ways to start, because men love to get us to have a challenge. He said, then what is it? And I said, I want you to see if you can travel 23 miles back on to the boat launch area without swearing or cursing. And then he said something very interesting. He said, my mother used to tell me that swearing is a sign of a poor vocabulary. Well, his mother was right, but that was a really good start. And so we went back up the lake, and he only messed up once. And when he did, he went like this, you know, put his hand to his mouth and looked like that. And I looked at him, enough said already. So on this, the first Sunday of the new year, listen for the voice of Jesus, reminding you that like Peter, he's got a work for you to do. And as long as we have breath, we can glorify God by how we live, how we love, how we communicate. God isn't finished with us yet. And God is the God of the second chance and the third chance and the fourth chance. And now I'd like to switch gears and focus not on individuals, but on your church here as a whole. Back in November, I came into our house and with a bucket of eggs from the hens. And Irene, as she loves to do, was working around the house and the music was cranked up pretty loudly. If I asked the volume be turned up on television for important things like news or sports, she rags on me sometimes a little bit. Does anybody do marriage counseling here? Anyways. She was playing a song that day that I'd heard snippets of before, but never really heard it in its entirety and never really learned it. And on this day, I really listened to the song. Its song was by the Browns called The Three Bells. And I liked the tune. Once again, Irene encouraged me by telling me I wasn't very good at duplicating it, but that's okay. As I washed my eggs, I was listening to these words. And I'd like John to play this song for you at this time, please. And really listen carefully because there are some questions afterwards. What thoughts worthy of passing on to you did I find in this song? Well, first, there are some comparisons or similarities between this church that they sang about in the song and your church here. Both are fairly small congregations. Both sit in a valley with high mountains like Mount Arrowsmith nearby. Although I will tell you that we on the other side of the hump claim Arrowsmith as our own. All right? But more importantly, both congregations have an important ministry to their respective communities.
Amen.
Did you notice the three specific times that that church in the valley ministered to the Jimmy Brown family? What were they? Birth,
marriage,
and death. When Jimmy Brown was born, when he married, when he died. Now, we have three big theological terms for these occasions. We say that when one is born, they are hatched. When they're married, they are matched. And when they die, they are dispatched. Now, I was kidding about deep theological terms there, but they're easy to remember and they rhyme. So, hatched, matched, and dispatched. When Jimmy Brown was born, the church bells rang in celebration. Appropriate prayers were offered up. They prayed for guidance from above. The church bells rang out again in celebration 20 years later when Jimmy Brown met his bride in the united and holy matrimony. And many years later, the church is there to grieve with the family and pray for them when Jimmy Brown died. And that little church was really appreciated by the Brown family. But I want to state very clearly this morning a few thoughts. It is not enough to have such minimal involvement with the church. It's not enough to be christened as a baby in the church, then 20 or so years later to be married in the church, and maybe 40 years or so later to be have a memorial service in the church and maybe be buried in the cemetery behind the church. That type of minimal involvement in the church does little to build a solid faith, which is so needed in our troubled times. A solid faith is built gradually. Or in the words of a Bible verse, here a little, there a little, line upon line, precept upon precept, Sunday after Sunday. And I know you believe that, or you wouldn't be here today. But to be fair to Jimmy Brown, the song does tell us that on the dark and dreary day, the soul of Jimmy Brown winged its way to heaven. And the church claimed him as their own with the words, "Our Jimmy Brown." And that indicates to me that Jimmy had been touched by the members and messages of the church far more than was mentioned on these three occasions. A second point from the song is closely related to the first. If the average member of that congregation only attended spasmodically, only gave a minimal offering once in a while, even those minimal things would probably have been impossible. Why? Because the church would have had to shut down years before due to lack of support. It takes money, it takes resources, it takes people to keep the church doors open.
Amen.
That congregation and this congregation exists because of members and adherents who attend faithfully, give generously, sometimes even sacrificially, and use their talents to work within the church and outside of the church to enhance and spread the gospel. It's not just done by the pastors. It's to be done by us all.
Amen, brother.
To summarize, although we have often let Jesus down, even denied him far too often, I want you to know that God isn't finished with us yet. Today I want you to imagine him coming alongside, putting a loving hand on your shoulder, and asking you a direct question. Do you love me? Do you love me more than the baubles you've been able to collect in your life? Do you love me more than your profession, more than your friends, more than anything else? And if your answer is yes, his answer is still much the same as he told Peter. Feed my lambs. Feed your children. Feed your grandchildren. Tell them Bible stories. Relate the Christian faith to them as you can. Feed my lambs. Tend my sheep. Nurture and encourage those who believe in me. Help me build up the kingdom of God. And on this first Sunday of the new year, commit yourself anew to being a strong supporter of this church by attending, by encouraging, by using your talents and gifts to build it up.
Yes.
I'll tell you, people, there's an awful lot of worried people out there today, largely due to the pandemic. Just the other day, I visited a neighbor of ours who's 97 years old. And he told me, he said, in my mind, he said, it's getting worse. And I was able to tell Bert, I said, yeah, it certainly looks like that. But there's coming a day when Jesus is going to return to this earth. And he's going to rule and reign on this earth for a period of 1,000 years, known as the millennial rule. And Jesus is going to do it right.
Hallelujah.
And it's going to be a blessed, blessed time. So do that as you're able to. Share with people that there is hope. That there is hope beyond this miserable pandemic that we've got going on right now.
Amen.
This year, really let your light shine. And may you have an opportunity to reach out to many a Jimmy Brown, many a Janie Brown in your community this year. Be a relatively small church, but have a great impact in the community. May God bless and use you. Very nice.
Thank you, brother. That was a great message to start off our new year. Ben requested this song, but it really brought me great joy because so often, you know, he said for us to come to him as children. We think of this as a children's song. But really, the truth is no different for us as adults than it is for children.
Amen.
So let's sing this joyous little song together. Let me put my eyes back on. And as you're singing it, I want you to think about the fact that we are meant to have a childlike faith. And so often we let the world drag us into its muddy mire. And if we can go back to being like children and having a childlike faith, we are so much better off.
Amen.
So let's enjoy this little song together before we break away. This little light of mine, feel free to stand up.
Oh,
God, we will shine for eternity, and we just need to do it down here a little while longer, and then we can do it up there. We look forward to that day. So God bless you, each and every one, until we see you hopefully again next Sunday, weather permitting and COVID permitting. And God bless you. And he doesn't change, thank God. Amen.